Hello, thanks for tuning in. I'm here with Filippo Grandi, the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, and we are at the African Union Summit in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, where the theme this year is devoted to refugees, returnees, that's people who finally get the chance to return home in peace, and internally displaced people. And we're going to have a little bit of discussion about why this is so significant. Why is it so significant, Commissioner?
It is the anniversary, the 50th anniversary of a very important international legal instrument, the Convention of the African Union on African Refugees, a very forward-looking
50th
instrument.
Right.
It's very old, 50th, from 1969. It is also, it happens to be the 10th anniversary of another unique legal instrument, which is the Kampala Convention on Internally Displaced, meaning the people that are refugees in their own countries. So the question is really, are anniversaries important? But if you look at the context, conflicts, poverty, climate change, combining to create more displacement internally or externally, I think that in this case, anniversaries are very important.
And conventions like these are important. What do you think that these particular conventions have meant for the people who've been forced to flee over decades since it was its adoption in Africa?
The African Union Convention builds on the Global Refugee Convention,
right,
which is even older, 1951, and tailors some of its concept to Africa, where traditionally a lot of the displacement has been caused by war, by conflict. So it is very topical, it is very current even today, where a lot of the displacement is caused by wars, wars that tend to last for many years, tend to repeat themselves, start again, even when they finish, and tend to be regional in nature. So these conventions that give obligations to the state that subscribe to them are extremely useful and relevant today.
Let's use an example then that will illustrate this. I think South Sudan is one, you just said, wars that repeat themselves.
The African Union Convention is really the convention that introduced the notion that refugees fleeing from conflict in large numbers need to be recognized as refugees in an expedited manner, often
and also,
as a group.
And there's a term for it, it's called prima facie.
It's called prima
what
facie,
does that
meaning,
mean?
Meaning that everybody who flees a certain conflict is recognized as a refugee, is not pushed back into his or her country, and is allowed to receive humanitarian assistance, have access to services, and so forth. So they're very practically important, these conventions. And they're very important today. This convention is 50 years old, but Africa today is unfortunately plagued with even more conflicts than when the convention was established 50 years ago.
We're seeing still large numbers of people not only still being forced to flee in Africa, but also many situations where refugees remain in limbo for a long time, sometimes even decades. What is the situation? Paint the picture for the challenges that Africa is facing today.
Yeah, when I said that the situation may even be worse than 50 years ago, is that conflicts today in all over the world, but in Africa in particular, tend to be very long, tend to last for many years. And sometimes, even when they end, they start again, because the causes that generated the conflict have not been addressed. And then often they're regional. They cover not only one country, but several countries are involved. And all of this makes conflicts more complicated to solve, and the lives of those impacted by conflicts more miserable.
Right, and I think a really good example that you illustrated to delegates here at the African Union Summit today was a very personal one that really struck you during a recent visit to Uganda. Can you talk about that?
Yes, I was in, I think it was a clinic, and a refugee man came to me and said, High Commissioner, I have studied your CV, and I have seen that we are exactly the same age. We were born the same year. And so you know what it means to live a certain number of years. We both lived the same number of years. And he said, you know, during those years, I was a refugee four times. Mm-hmm. And this really struck me. I thought of my own life, of my own very privileged life, where I never had to flee from any war, from any deprivation, from any violence. And I thought of this man who had lived the same number of years, and for four times he had to leave everything behind, and for four times he had to reconstruct everything, reconstruct a new life. And I thought, how much harder can it get?
So on one hand, you saw that, you know, the effect of these wars on his life, but you were in a country, Uganda, who had received this man four times. Does this say something about the hospitality of the African people, of countries in Africa?
Yes, and indeed I remember that the conversation with this man continued precisely on this topic, and I said, so you came to Uganda? Yes, because this was the closest border he could cross. Every time it was very dangerous. He was fleeing from war, from violence. He would have been killed otherwise. Mm. And of course, he said every time Uganda provided asylum, which means really protection, safety, and access to basic requirements like food, water, medicines. But also, he said the second time he fled, he had his children with him. Mm-hmm. So his children could go to school. Mm-hmm. He got a piece of land. Uganda has very progressive policies that we are trying to use as an example in other parts of the world. And so in a way, that was the positive part of a very sad and tragic history.
Right, and he was never forced back too. And I think that's one of the key principles of that convention, of the 1951 convention, that people should never be forced to return unless they want to do so.
Absolutely, and this is one of the key principles that we always remind governments, remind states to observe. Because one has to understand, especially in these contexts where people are fleeing war and violence, to say to people, you cannot cross this border, you have to go back home, is equal to condemning this person to death. This is why we say that conventions that we, whose anniversaries we celebrate now, conventions are, yes, documents, but they are life-saving documents.
They're life-saving documents. You have traveled a lot in Africa over your career and as High Commissioner for Refugees over this past 3 years. And I know you always go to the capitals and you meet the leadership, but then you travel to the refugee camps and settlements or to where refugees are in cities and towns. Is there something particularly African that strikes you about these visits?
I've been saying today here at the summit and on other occasions that, of course, Africa, sadly, is the theater, is the place where a third of the world displacement occurs. A third of the refugees of the world are here in Africa. So that's sad, but Africa is also the continent where no matter how many resources are available, and usually there's very few resources available, people are the most generous. You know, I have been in the most remote villages of this continent, where sharing the little that people have by way of food or water or shelter, sharing with foreigners that are in distress because they had to flee, this sharing is not, like in other richer parts of the world, the subject of political negotiations, but is a natural instinct, is rooted in the values, in the absolute values of a tradition, of a culture, and of a society. And I don't say this lightly. I say this because I have seen it over and over again in so many parts of Africa. We also have to say one more thing. This solidarity is there. People have it naturally, but we should not take it for granted. The resources on this continent are limited, although the opportunities are many. So I think it is important that we share this solidarity. You know, this is also the first year in which we implement the Global Compact on Refugees, which was adopted by the United Nations just recently. And this Global Compact says exactly that. Refugees are international responsibility, so we know you all need to share.
And don't leave countries that are hosting large numbers of refugees alone, or the humanitarian actors like UNHCR as the only...
Don't leave countries, don't leave local communities. We're just coming here to Ethiopia from Tanzania, where we visited a large refugee camp, 150,000 people. This is many more that have crossed the Mediterranean last year or the year before. 150,000 people in the poorest area of Tanzania, and yet the local people share. But it would be a mistake to forget about them. We need to help the refugees, but we also need to help the local community who have very often the same or even more acute
needs.
Right,
like one of the examples was the healthcare. I mean, the refugees were saying the healthcare is not adequate enough, but then you learned that actually for the host community, the healthcare was even worse. So this is an example of why you need to invest not just in that refugee camp, but beyond.
Yes, in fact, they told us that the local people were going to the clinics in the refugee camps because they could get better treatment. Which means what? Which means that the model of an isolated camp with its own assistance is over. That really what the compact says is that assistance support has to be broad to refugees and local communities. And what really is important is for the time during which refugees need asylum and protection, they need to be as included as possible in services, in livelihoods, in communities, and then the support has to be for everybody, for those communities and for the refugees that they host.
And you're going to be going to see an important example of that here in Ethiopia, a region called Dolo Ado, and a big project by our biggest private partner, which is the IKEA Foundation. And tell us, describe a little bit of this example and what you hope to see.
This is one of our most special projects because it's really the result of a cooperation between UNHCR, the government of Ethiopia, a very forward-looking government, and a very big business partner, IKEA, a very famous company making furniture that everybody knows. Everybody knows IKEA.
Has struggled with.
IKEA has a foundation that very generously funds this project, but more than that, helps us really run these projects in a new way, give self-reliance, livelihoods to refugees, looks at host community, looks at the environment, and tries to make this project sustainable. Many positive aspects that come from the experience in the private sector. So it's really a coalition, an alliance between different forces, which is what the Compact on Refugees wants to promote.
Right, and this will serve as a blueprint for other companies or organizations who want to come in and pitch in and help as well.
Yes, we have, for example, also a very interesting initiative in Kenya, where the World Bank has helped us explore the possibility for private businesses to invest in a situation where there are refugees. It was not big business, it was very much regional business, local business that invested in the food industry, for example. I think this is important because it will also hopefully contribute to turn around the narrative around refugees. They're always depicted as victims, as vulnerable people, and of course they are also that. But I think that this helps portray them, project them as people with potential, people with opportunities, people with something not only to take but to give back and to give to the community.
But also that their arrival can attract investment, right? I would be remiss, we're here in Ethiopia, not to ask you about the policies and the current new policies of the very hopeful for refugee protection of the Ethiopian government.
Yes, because we have spoken about conventions of many decades ago, but of course, the legislation of each country continues to evolve. And nowhere has refugee legislation has evolved as much as positively as here in Ethiopia. Very recently, just a few days ago, a new proclamation, as it is called here, a new law on how to deal with refugees was approved by the Ethiopian institutions. And this puts Ethiopia in the forefront of progressive, inclusive, rights-based legislation. And that's why Ethiopia is one of our most trusted partners, showing the way, exercising leadership in this important field.
Well, I think on that note, we'll end this conversation for today, and we'll be coming back with more from the field. Thank you very much for joining this conversation.
Thank you, and thank you to all those who have followed us.
Thank you.